Throughout salvation history, God reveals himself to us as a communion of persons. In the book of Genesis, God says, "Let us make man in our image." When Jesus teaches his disciples to pray, he begins with the words, "Our Father who art in heaven." And at the Great Commission, before he ascends the Father, Jesus compels his followers to go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Just as God reveals himself to us as a communion of persons, he calls us into Christian life together as a community. Christianity is not a single-player sport. We belong to each other. Even prayer, which is always personal, is never private. Our one-on-one relationship with God also unites us more closely to the body of Christ, the church. This is why it's so important that each of us is committed to a particular parish community. When we show up every Sunday at Mass, we not only grow closer to our relationship with God, but to one another as well. As Pope Benedict said in Deus Caritas Est, love of God and love of neighbor form a single commandment. Our love of neighbor is especially important in our world and country today. It's increasingly divided, polarized, and competitive. To love means, first of all, to show up. This is why parish hopping, or not being actively involved in the life of our parishes, or if we're involved in our church but only spend time with a small group of like-minded friends, it limits our own ability to be a follower of Jesus and to participate in the larger mission of the church in the world, to go and make disciples. Many people today in the 21st century have questioned, is parish an outdated institution? Do we really need parishes when we can be hyper-connected to community online or in a diversity of ways? As St. John Paul II tells us, the church finds its most immediate and visible expression in the local parish. The parish is the church living in the midst of the homes of her sons and daughters. Pope Francis encourages us not to set parish life aside, but to reimagine it, saying, the parish is not an outdated institution, precisely because it possesses great flexibility. It can assume quite different contours, depending on the openness and missionary creativity of the pastor and the community. Many people may not experience their parish as being this great institution of flexibility and new ideas, but Pope Francis encourages us to step in to be protagonists of a new vision of church life and parish life, rather than stepping aside or relying on other people to take the lead. To make this hope a reality, Pope Francis encourages each of us to a renewed imagination of parish life, not to step out or slowly drift away from the life of our parishes. Pope Francis gives us a beautiful image of what parish life can look like in the 21st century. Rather than a sphere that's perfectly rounded, he invites us to see parish life as a polyhedron, sort of in a regular shape with various sides and sizes. A polyhedron reminds us that just like a family is not regular and perfect, so too our parishes bring together a diversity of perspectives, languages, and voices, all to be valued, recognizing the dignity of every human person within our own parish communities. But a polyhedron also reminds us that many of those sizes and sides of parish life are missing and need to be more fully represented in the life of our parishes. Whether people are old or young, active in the life of the church, or have drifted away, we're called to go out and make disciples of all nations and to ensure that our parishes are those flexible institutions that are ready and willing to welcome new people. We can recognize the different shapes and sizes of parish life when we consider that a parish, as Pope Francis says, is a family of families, where small communities, ecclesial movements, and associations live in harmony. Every parish is called to be as unique as its people. Parishes bring together the gifts, diversity, and experiences of all the people of God together. In an earlier era, parish boundaries used to tell people specifically where to go to church. But today, parish boundaries more tell the church where to go to the people. As we seek to grow into the type of community that welcomes all people within our neighborhoods and communities, Pope Francis encourages us to set aside the mentality that it's always been done this way, but rather to be encouraged by new ideas, to go out and to be close to our people, to prioritize closeness as a principle of community life, especially being close to those who are often set aside or marginalized in our communities. The call to community life is specifically a call to a greater awareness of the needs and gifts of the people of God in our parishes and in our larger communities who we may be missing. As Living as Missionary Disciples tells us, the community of faith is a place of invitation, welcome, and hospitality, especially for those who are inquiring or returning. When I talk to young people about what's most attractive to them about a parish community, the word that comes up over and over again is home. Young people and old people alike are looking for a spiritual home in their local parish. As we cultivate an imagination of what that spiritual home can look like, it's valuable to think about the best qualities of home life. A home is a place where someone knows your name, where you have a key to the door, where you're always welcomed in no matter how many days or years you've been away. A home is a place where you're nourished and fed. It's a place where you're encouraged and sent on mission. It's a place where you're affirmed and forgiven. Our parish communities are called to be true spiritual homes for those who are regular participants of our local parish and those who have been away maybe for a long time. Even though our parishes are called to be spiritual homes, it doesn't mean that we are called to be spiritual homebodies. The church is not some home base in a cosmic game of tag, where we spend most of our time in the church to keep us safe and sound. Rather, our parishes ought to be fueling us and forming us for lifelong mission in the world. As Living as Missionary Disciples tells us, the community of faith, the parish, does not remain focused on itself, but instead sends disciples out on mission. To accomplish this hopeful vision of parish life, we can no longer rely on 5 or 10% of parishioners who are most involved doing all the work and activity of the local parish. This vision requires each person to be formed and inspired to be an active participant in the life and the mission of the local parish, active in the church and in the world. Christian community is less of a particular place than a reality that we live out. As Scripture tells us, where 2 or 3 are gathered, there am I in the midst of them. As you reflect upon your own parish and how they're living out this call to Christian community, I invite you to consider a couple questions. What percentage of our parishioners are actively involved in the church in terms of their time, talent, and treasure? What opportunities does our parish offer for adult faith formation, for helping our parish live as an intentional community of followers of Jesus Christ? Whether that be ongoing retreats, small groups, days of reflection, opportunities to really be and practice our faith together. Do our parish ministries form authentic communities, or are they places where people show up to fulfill ministry tasks? Do people in the choir and the RCIA and the Knights of Columbus know each other by name, share prayer together, and be involved in each other's lives? Does our parish offer hospitality, not only after the most packed Mass, but after every Sunday Mass? Are there ways where someone who comes to the quiet Mass on Sunday morning, or only the Saturday vigil, can form authentic friendships and community in the life of the parish? As we reflect on our sacramental preparation programs, do our ministry programs accompany people into our communities of faith? Are marriage prep couples and baptism prep couples and RCIA candidates and catechumens still involved or actively involved in the life of our parish communities 2, 3, or 4 years later? Do our Catholic schools and religious ed programs accompany young families and children not only for the year or two that they're in programs, but into the life of the community for the rest of their lives? Is our parish stuck in the "it's always been done this way" mentality? Do we focus all of our time and energy on hosting events and programs instead of recognizing that the goal of those hosted events and programs are to build relationships and get to know the names of new people in the life of our parish communities? One of the challenges facing our institutions of parish life today is that more and more people are becoming less trusting of institutions and more trusting of personal relationships. Fewer people are only shopping at stores and malls and are shopping more online and individually. They're shopping at farmers markets, places where they build personal relationships with those they engage with. People increasingly aren't only going to big box gyms, but are finding small fitness groups and classes where they're known by name, where people notice if they don't show up, where there's some accountability, and they've got a coach to set personal customized goals. How can our parishes take on this method and style of personal relationships and relational authority to help form people for lifelong missionary discipleship? The aim of community life is to help all the baptized grow in holiness to be more like the person of Christ, not just on Sundays, but throughout the week, that we are forming people for lifelong mission in their workplaces, neighborhoods, families, and the larger world. As our churches accompany people into community life, the role of the parish community is to help each baptized person grow in holiness through the sacramental life of the church, that they may be formed and sent on mission as missionary disciples.